We continue the consideration of linear operations with geometric vectors. Last time we proved the result that three oncoplanar vectors form a basis in the space of geometric vectors. Which means the following. Every vector from the space is their unique linear combination, which means for any vector A in space, you can write it as A1 E1 plus A2 E2 plus A3 E3, this is formula 1, where E1, E2, E3 is a triple of vectors which form a basis, a triple of non-coplanar vectors, and by this reason, because this representation 1 is unique for every vector, we call this vectors a basis. The numbers A1, A2, A3 are called the coordinates. Of vector A in the basis E1, E2, E3. We have our experience with the plane of vectors and space R2, from which we know that in a different basis, a vector will be given by a different set of coordinates. And therefore, basis is important. Yeah? So the word the coordinates in this basis. So for every vector, there exists a set of coordinates. Yes? If we have another vector, let's say vector B, which has an expansion in this basis, B1, E1, plus B2, E2, plus B3, E3. This will be formula number 2. So, for two different vectors, we understand that you can perform linear operations on them. And as a result of this linear operation, if you add vector A plus vector B, the resulting vector, when we add the respective vectors written in their expansion and factor out the basis vectors using properties of linear operations, it will be A1 plus B1 E1 plus A2 plus B2 E2 plus A3 plus B3, E3. And if you multiply any of these vectors, A or B, by some scalar, by some number, for instance, by number K, so vector KA, I will just use the properties of linear operations and multiply through in this bracket. And then we have ka1, ka2, ka3, new coordinates of the vector ka. ka1, e1 plus ka2, e2 plus ka3, e3. As we can see that when you add vectors, their coordinates add, and when you multiply a vector by a number, each coordinate is multiplied by this number. And by this reason, we can assign to vectors A and B columns of their coordinates, three columns, or triples of numbers. So we can say, for instance, vector A, when the basis is given, will be identified with a column A1, A2, A3. And vector B will be identified with column B1, B2, B3. And according to the law for addition of vectors, which follows from our definitions of linear operations, when we add vectors A and B, or respective columns, the coordinates must add. That's how we derive our law for addition of columns. So we can say that vector A plus B will be described by a column with which coordinates? These coordinates: A1 plus B1, A2 plus B2, A3 plus B3. That's right, it will be column A1 plus B1, A2 plus B2, A3 plus B3, and vector KA will be identified with the column KA1, KA2, KA3. This will be formula 3 for today. It's just a good definition for the linear operations columns, and we can check the properties of linear operations. Check the properties of linear operations. I will just write briefly properties 1 to 8. We derived for geometric vectors, and then we said that any set which has linear operations defined on them, which means operations with properties 1 to 8, right? Properties 1 to 8, commutative law, associative law, the existence of zero, the multiplication, the existence of the inverse, yes? This set is a vector space, yes? We can check that properties of linear operations, properties 1 to 8, hold. Thus, the set of three columns. What is three columns? A column with three entries. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. The set of three columns with the operations defined by formula 3 is a vector space called, there is a standard name for this space, R3. That's the name of this space. It is called R3. So what's important? We have the properties of linear operations. We have the set, these linear operations defined. How did we define? We define them in a reasonable way because we copied our definitions from what we have for vectors. Yes? Is a vector space called R3. Sometimes they say arithmetic space R3. The space of three columns. it's pretty clear that in space of three columns, the zero vector will be vector with coordinates 0, 0, 0. The vector opposite to vector A, negative A, will be of course vector negative A1, negative A2, and negative A3. And you can check that all the other properties of linear regressions hold. Distributive law, associative law, commutative law of addition, all of them hold. What else? We do have also in R3 the standard basis. It's a basis that we call standard. It's not the only basis. Standard basis. What is standard basis? It consists of vectors. If we suggest that E1, E2, E3 is our basis, then we will say E1 will be 1, 0, 0. E2 will be 0, 1, 0. And E3 will be 0, 0, 1. It's pretty clear to see. It's pretty easy to see that it is true. Yes, for instance, vector E2 I will take. Vector E2 can be seen as 0 times E1 plus 1 times E2 plus 0 times E3. The other vectors have analogous expansion. We understand also that there may be other bases. There may be other bases, and these other bases may be as good as a standard one. They will also give you a unique expansion for every vector living in this space. And how do you determine if three vectors are a basis or not? You know the geometric definition. These vectors must be non-coplanar. They should not lie in one plane. There must be three of them. And they must be non-coplanar. Yes? How do we know in algebraic terms? We will see a little bit later. The only thing I have to mention again, thus for every vector in the space of vectors, we have a triple of numbers when the basis is chosen. Yes? We have this correspondence vector A, corresponds to column A1, A2, A3. Is it also working the other way around? So, is there a unique vector A for every column in R3? And the answer is, unfortunately, not a unique vector. This emphasis on the unique. So there exists vector, of course there exists vector. You take number A1 multiplied by E1, A2 by E2, A3 by E3, you have a vector. But is it unique? We know that vectors can be parallel translated in space. So this vector A, and this is also vector A, yes? There are three vectors, so-called three vectors. And this is also vector A. And you have infinitely many vectors A in this space which are equal to each other. But we want to have a unique one. So we will introduce in space a coordinate system. Some point O, the origin, O, which is some point we choose in space, and a basis. And V we will identify, so we have this coordinate system, yes, we have a basis. So suppose this, there is a basis, yes, E1, bigger picture, E1, and there will be vector E2, and there will be vector E3. I don't want to make an impression that this system is rectangular or something, we don't really care. This is E3. And we start all three vectors from the same origin. They will emanate from the same point O. And we will associate coordinate axes with these vectors. With the first vector, of course, we associate coordinate axes. I don't have much room, so I will draw it like this. X, 1. And with this vector, we will associate the coordinate axes X, 2. And with this vector, we will associate coordinate axis x3, okay. So there is vector e3 and the coordinate axis x3 or xyz, call them whatever you want. So we have this coordinate system. Coordinate system. I can write it like this. O and the basis E1, E2, E3. That's a convenient notation for a coordinate system. Now, every point in space is characterized by a single vector. Every point, for instance, this point A in the space, we can connect it with the origin by some vector. And this vector A, I can identify with A, yeah. So this is already not a free vector, this is a position vector. So vector OA equals to A is a position vector. A position vector of point A. So our vectors lose their freedom. What do we acquire when vectors lose their freedom? We must get something good for this. As a payment for losing freedom. Yeah? We will get coordinates. Now every set of coordinates is in correspondence with a unique position vector. Yeah? So every set of coordinates, A1, A2, A3, is in correspondence with vector OA equal to vector A, the position vector of position vector of point A. Now the correspondence between columns and vectors are one to one. Yes, for every vector we have unique column, for every column we have unique vector. So there is an we call it an isomorphism. When there is one-one correspondence and it is preserved by linear operations, yes, this isomorphism between the position vectors, positions, position vectors in space and the space R3 of three columns. Also, by introducing the coordinate system, we acquire a great opportunity of assigning coordinates to points. Yes? So each point A in space, each point, for instance, point A in space, is assigned coordinates of its position vector. So for instance, when we say that the coordinates of point A are A1, A2, A3. So for instance, when I say the coordinates of point A are, let's give them names, XA, YA, ZA, when I say these words, it means that there is some coordinate system. I don't know how it looks like. This is a coordinate system, that's point O. And if I connect it with point A, that vector OA is XA E1 plus YA E2 plus ZA E3. That's what it meant. If I have some other point, this point B. It is characterized by vector OB. And when I say that B has coordinates XB, YB, ZB, it means literally the following, that vector OB has coordinates XB, E1 plus YB, E2. Plus ZB E3. So each point is assigned a set of coordinates according to the coordinates vector of the position vector. By the way, it allows us to find coordinates of vectors connecting two points. For instance, this vector AB. If I join these two points by means of I can say that vector AB will be what? Look here. OA plus AB is OB. Yes? I first start with the sum by triangle rule because it's easier. OA plus AB equals OB. Triangle rule really looks very, very nice and natural, yes? Especially keeping in mind that you have kind of a chain rule, you can think, yes, OA plus AB, you see, if we have A and A, like convolute together, yes, and we have what? We started with O, we ended with B, OB, that's what we have. That's the nice thing about the triangle rule, yes, you just follow the vectors. So, from this equality, we can of course obtain that AB vector will be OB minus OA. If, for instance, we have an example, simple problem, we need to know the direction of some vector or something else, so we can say find the coordinates of vector, let's say, MN. If point M has coordinates 3, 10, 12, and point N has coordinates 1, negative 1, 5. So it's pretty easy, and if you forget, you just always, I wrote here vector n, no, it's a point, it's this size. The coordinates of point m are 3, 10, 12. The coordinates of point n are 1, negative 1, 5. So we can always quickly draw a picture. There must be some coordinate system. It starts at point O, right? Then we have point m somewhere here, for instance. Conventional pictures, and point n somewhere here. This is point N, this is point M. We can join them by this vector. This is vector MN, yes? It starts at M and ends at N. So, what are coordinates of M? You can see that O, M plus M n must be O n. So by subtraction you get that M n is O n minus O m. Or it will be, it's more convenient to work in columns, 1 minus 1, 5 minus 3, 10, so subtract two columns. What will be the resulting column? 1 minus 3, minus 1 minus 10, 5 minus 12. So it will be negative 2, negative 11, negative 7. These are the coordinates of vector MN. So this is a column corresponding. Actually, you can see right away the advantage of this analytical approach or numerical approach to describing geometry of three space, because we can solve very sophisticated problems which would be very difficult to solve by means of diagrams and by means of elementary geometry. We can solve these problems easily. That's why Descartes was so proud of his invention of coordinate systems and therefore ability of people to describe the vectors, to describe the three-dimensional space and coordinate system. For example, that's a classical problem. Find the coordinates of the point M that divides segment AB in the ratio to 3, and it is superfluous, but just to make clear, I will say starting from A. It's pretty clear, so I said, since I said segment AB, it's pretty clear that you consider segment starting from A, ending at B. Where we need coordinates of A and B. A has coordinates negative 1, 3, 10, and B has coordinates 4, 8, 20. It is unimaginable even to try to draw a picture in three-dimensional space, because we are not good at drawing three-dimensional pictures in the plane. When you draw a system of coordinates, any system of coordinates, yes, these are your coordinate axes, for instance, E1, E2, T3 and they span certain planes, there's another plane, and there is another plane. Yeah? If I put a point here, can you tell me if this point is lying above this part of the plane spanned by E1 and 2? If I draw perpendicular, where will it fall? Will it fall here? Or if I drop it, it must fall here. We don't see things in two-dimensional pictures. We don't see how the things really are in space. So it's very difficult. But we can just use these numbers to solve, to find the coordinates. How will I do it? I will suggest there is coordinate system starting at some point O. There is point A. And there is point B. Right? I can draw specifies that O is the origin of the coordinate system. I draw some three vectors sticking out of it. And this is vector OB, which gives us coordinates of point B. This is vector OA, which gives us coordinates of point A. And we need to find on this segment point that divides the segment in the ratio of 2 to 3. So it's 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, approximately. So this point must be located approximately. That's the point we need to find. Yeah? We can view. So essentially, we have to find the coordinates of vector OM. OM is the vector which we would like to find. OM is the vector which we would like to find. So what is the vector OM? I can tell you what is vector OM. I can view vector OM as vector OA plus this little vector, AM. And vector AM is collinear with vector AB, right? This is vector from A to B. So vector AM is proportional to vector AB. Moreover, we can say that vector AM occupies two parts of the whole five parts of vector AB. I will write it like this. So vector OM is OA plus AM. Or you can say OA is given vector. We don't care about it because it's given. This is vector OA. It has coordinates minus 1, 3, 10. Plus vector AM. Vector AM is directed exactly the same as vector AB, but the length is smaller. It has only two parts out of 2 plus 3. I will write it literally like this. 2 out of 2 plus 3 parts of vector AB. Right? All together, we divide in the ratio of 2 to 3. So there are two parts here and three parts here. All together, it's a vector AB consists of these five small units, and our vector AM consists of only two of them. So the coefficient of proportionality will be 2 over 5. Yeah? So it will be vector OA plus 2/5 of vector AB is what? OB minus OA, because we are given points A and B, which means we are given vectors OB and OA. Yeah? Or I will write OA plus 2/5 OB and minus 2/5 OA. So OA minus 2/5 OA will produce 3/5 OA. Yes? The whole OA is 5/5 minus 2/5. So it will be 3/5 OA plus 2/5 of OB. You can write it also this way. You can factor out 1/5 and here you will have 3 OA plus 2 OB. Short of room here, but I will move here. So I continue here. Vector, it's vector OM. We started here. So vector OM is 1/5 2OA plus, no, 3OA, sorry. 3 vectors OA plus 2 vectors OB. And then we can substitute our numbers, 1/5. And here will be 3 times negative 1, 3, 10, negative 1, 3, 10, plus 2 times 4, 8, 20. So it will be 1/5. Now perform operations on these columns. Negative 3 plus 4, I will. Negative 3 plus 4. Plus 8, I'm very sorry, 2 times 4, yes, negative 3 times 1, 2 times 4 plus 8, 9 plus 16, and 30 plus 40. So it will be 5 1/5. So it will be a column with entries 1, 5, 14. Then you can say point M has coordinates 1, 5, 14. That's our answer. Now I think we can move forward if we have enough time. Let me see about this. Probably we have to stop here and continue in the next lecture. In the next lecture, we are going to find out interesting things. It looks like every time, whenever we deal with certain space, our basis consists of a certain number of vectors. When we had a line of vectors, the whole line can be spanned by one vector in a unique way, one non-zero vector. All the other vectors are collinear with it. If you have a plane of vectors, we need two non-collinear vectors, and then every vector is their unique linear combination. In space of vectors, we have three, we need to have for a basis, three non-coplanar vectors, so three vectors not lying in the same plane. So, and then we can describe every vector by unique set of numbers. This means there is something, there exists for every kind of space, there exists a magic number called its dimension. And in the next time, in the next class, we will learn how to determine what is this number and how to find out whether few vectors are deserving to be a basis or not. It will be a lecture about our next notion, will be linear dependence and independence.